Our first lesson is from Isaiah chapter 60, the first six verses. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For darkness shall cover the earth, the thick darkness of the peoples. But the Lord will rise upon you, and his glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look around. They all gather together. They come to you. Your sons shall come from far away, and your daughters shall be carried on their nurses' arms. Then you shall see and be radiant. Your heart shall thrill and rejoice, because the abundance of the sea shall be brought to you. The wealth of the nations shall come to you. A multitude of camels shall cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah. All those from Sheba shall come, and they shall bring gold and frankincense and shall proclaim the praise of the Lord. Amen. I invite us now to sing together, What Child Is This? Hymn number 219. Let us stand. Be seated. Before I read the gospel lesson, just want to say it's wonderful to be in a church where the congregation enjoys singing out. And I'm not just saying that to you because the choir members are out there with you. Every single Sunday, you sing songs of praise, and it's not just the season, but it's wonderful to lift up our hearts and voices in songs of praise to God. Our gospel lesson is from Matthew 2. Here is Matthew's story of the visit of the wise men. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who's been born king of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and the scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. And they told him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for it has been written by the prophet, "And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out. And there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then opening their treasure chest, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Move freely among us, we pray. Leave the meditations in our hearts and minds. May they be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and redeemer. Come, Holy Spirit, come, we pray. Amen. Today we finish our series on There's a Song in the Air. And I hope that you've enjoyed this series as much as I have in this Advent Christmas Epiphany cycle. The songs that we've been highlighting the past few Sundays are songs that have been part of our Christmas experience every single year. And not just for Christmas, but for Advent and on this day of the Epiphany of the Lord that we celebrate as Epiphany Sunday. These carols have done for us what they do every single year. They shape our experience of Christmas and our understanding of that first Christmas, as well as inspire certain feelings and emotions as we think about what God with us, Emmanuel, really means, this understanding of the incarnation. Many of the Christmas carols, they invite us into the story to be in that nativity scene, but by the time we get past that first or second stanza, we are invited to sing more, and then we are finding verses that encourage us to consider what God with us requires from us, with our actions, with our way of thinking, with our responses to the knowledge that Jesus was sent to the world to take away the sins of the world, but also Jesus was sent in the world to take away my sin, your sin. And how we respond, not only in the season of Christmas and on this day of Epiphany of the Lord, but throughout the year, reveals whether the babe that was born in a manger has found his place in our hearts and in our lives. I realize to hear the truth of the Christmas story, we attend to the scriptures. And we've done that even as we've been highlighting the carols. The reading of the scriptures when the congregation assembles to worship is the key element of worship. Everything leads up to the reading of the scripture, and everything, the sermon, follows the reading of the scripture, that scripture being read, and then there's proclamation. And that's not just true in this Christmas season when we sing the songs we love to sing, but we come to the scripture verses and we are to live out what God has meant to us. So everything leading up to the scriptures and all that follows is in response. Our lives are to be one long hallelujah unto the Lord. That said, the carols have done their part in leading us to hear God's word, and they certainly do their part in helping us connect with the story, helping us connect with the truth of the biblical story, with what we are experiencing. And they continue to invite us to ponder the significance of the season, even when we are humming the tune or singing the tune on a Tuesday morning as we're unloading the dishwasher, on a Friday afternoon, we're singing the carols and the song as we drive from place to place. However, when we add the carols into the mix of our experience of Christmas, we find ourselves going beyond the scriptures and into a different realm, the realm of tradition, and dare I say it, legend. The beloved carol, We Three Kings, is the one of the main carols, not of the early part of the Christmas season, but toward the end. It fits today. It is a carol that's usually paired with the gospel story from Matthew, as we just heard Matthew tell us once again the story of the visit of the wise men. And in this carol, we don't just have the scripture. We have tradition. And can I say it again? We've got legend. Whether we want to admit it or not, this carol has shaped our understanding of the visit of the wise men as much as the scriptures have. This carol, written by the Reverend John Henry Hopkins Jr., was first published in a book of poems in 1862, but it had a hard time making the cut. It had a hard time because many publishers did not like this hymn. Unlike several of the other songs that we've been singing in the air in the season, this carol was written by an American clergyman who was also gifted with writing songs. And this song was written and first used in a pageant. In a pageant. A children's pageant. As we sang it, can't you just envision three little children dressed up marching to the tune of We Three Kings as they make their way to the Christ child? I can envision a young child with an oversized king's outfit and the crown slipping on the nose, and they constantly putting it up and slipping back down, and they kneel down before the Christ child. I envision that. Why? Because I've actually seen it over and over again, year after year, as the next generation of children live out the story. I once served a church where the young girls far outnumber the young boys. And so instead of three kings, we had three royal queens marching down to pay homage to the newborn king, and the congregation went in an uproar. This carol, it's fit for a pageant. In the same way a way in a manger is, perhaps those two carols are among the favorites among our children. And when we were children, we loved those songs. And if we love them as a child, we probably still love these songs. Several hymnologists, yes, that is a word. Several hymnologists, and I would assume pastors and theologians, had strong objections to this hymn when it was introduced beyond that seminary in New York where it was first used as a pageant or in a pageant. There were those who objected to including this carol among the other cherished and well-respected carols because they believed that to sing this song would perpetuate a falsehood, when what we want and what we come to expect is biblical truth, especially when we are gathered together in worship and we lift up the scriptures before all of us to hear. This carol has shaped our understanding of what happened at Christmas time. This story has shaped our understanding of the Epiphany, of how we even read the Matthew text. If you don't think so, just how many wise men do you think made the journey? We don't sing about 5 kings or 10 kings or 25 or 150 kings. How many do we sing of? 3. As if there were just 3 people who traveled from a faraway land to come visit the Christ child. That is so highly unlikely that there were just 3 visitors. I mean, there's safety in numbers when you're traveling that far. To travel that far, there would likely have been a caravan of people, wise men and assistants and other scholars and scribes and servants and so on. A small gathering of three people would not have gotten Jerusalem all in a stir. King Herod would have looked at those three and cast them off. The scripture says, King Herod and all of Jerusalem were terrified, frightened. A number larger than three people would have had to been the case. Yet we sing about three kings mainly because there are three gifts that are offered to the Christ child. And we know the gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And if we were to see three kings, more than three kings in a pageant, we might be quick to respond, that's not how the story goes. And I imagine on that day when those three royal queens walked in, even though most were chuckling and laughter, I imagine they refused on, that's not how the story goes. But the number is not the falsehood. It's not the legend that the theologians and hymnologists protested. It was the use of the word kings in designating these Gentile visitors from a foreign land that people protested the inclusion of this carol. The Gospel of Matthew is the only account of the visit of these travelers from the east, and in the scriptural account, they're not called kings, called wise men. The only kings in the story are paranoid king and King Herod and the newborn king in Jesus. In every nativity set I have ever seen, in every nativity scene I've seen acted out among children and even adults, I've only seen people dressed up like kings with crowns on their heads, and they're usually dressed regally. So yes, this hymn has greatly influenced our understanding of the Christmas story. So if there were not kings, then who were they? Were they simply wise men who were not Jewish people but had enough wisdom to read the scriptures and know in their reading of the Hebrew text that a star shall come out of Jacob and a scepter shall rise out of Israel? Were they astrologers? Were they magi, meaning that they were of a priestly sect from Persia? Or worse, could they have been people who practice sorcery, or even magicians of some sort? And so now we get a sense of the angst that some had over this carol. But whoever they were, wise men, kings, magi, aristocrats, magicians, sorcerers, this is all truly secondary to the fact that these people, these whoever they were, represented the other. The other is included in the story. The other, meaning those who are on the outside, have been invited to look in. Those who are not close have come to visit the newborn king. And when I say not close, I'm not just talking in terms of geography or the length of time of that journey, which was more than a few days, more like a few months or maybe even a year, so as to complete that journey from Persia. But not close means being among a people who are not Jewish, not among the people of Israel, but people far removed from the blessings that come with being in covenant relationship with God. I like how the Reverend Nadia Bolz Weber puts it in her book, Accidental Saints. She was the founding pastor of a Lutheran church in Denver. Hear what she writes about. A closer reading of Matthew shows that we have no idea how many people there were. We don't know how far east they had come from. Was it the Orient? Was it New Jersey? When they found the child, they entered not a stable or a barn with a manger, but a house. And most importantly, they were not kings. They're a magi, as in magicians, and not the cute kind you hire for your kid's birthday party. More likely, they were opportunistic, pagans, soothsaying, tarot card reading astrologers. And yet history has made them out to be kings, maybe because the reality that they were magicians is too distasteful. Since no one really wants the weird fortune teller lady from the circus with her scars and crystal balls to be the first one to discover the birth of our Lord. So the story has been niced up into an idealized picture of multicultural diplomacy. We like nice and tidy, especially when it comes to Christmas. We want all things to be calm and bright, as the song that we love to sing on Christmas Eve suggests. We want to sing the songs of great joy. And if but for a moment in our worship and the singing of the songs, we can escape the harsh realities of the world or maybe what's going on in our own lives. The visit of these wise men, kings, or magicians, be they 300, is of great importance, for with the inclusion of the story at the birth of Jesus, we have a great understanding that God with us is not just for the people of Israel, not just the Hebrew people, the people of the covenant, but for all of us. Meaning Jesus was sent for all of humanity, not just to be the Savior for some, but the Savior for all. Not just the Savior of the shepherds, but all the others, whoever the others were, whoever the others are. God sent Jesus to redeem the whole world, the whole messy, sin-stained world. And though we want to gaze into the idolized nativity displays, we must understand that when Jesus came, everything was not calm and bright and clean and genteel as we often display it, but rather in Jesus, God came into messy lives, into our messy world. God continues to come into our messy world and into our messy lives. Not to judge, to love, to redeem, to rescue, to save us. That healing balm in Gilead. Jesus was sent, yes, for the saints, but also the sinners, for the poor and the rich, the people who were already at home with God, as well as the immigrant from a foreign land. When we look at the nativity and we see the shepherds on one side representing the Jewish people, and we see the wise men representing the Gentiles on the other, even though biblically they weren't there at the same time, we do get a sense of what Paul later on would write about when he speaks of all who've been baptized into Christ. When he writes, you're no longer Jew or Greek, no longer slave or free, there's no longer male or female, but all of you, all of us are one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. So whether you identify more with Luke's gospel and the story of the shepherds, or of Matthew's gospel with the inclusion of the magi or the wise men, or you're somewhere in between, we are to find ourselves on bended knee to worship Christ, our newborn King. And I hope that on this day that we celebrate the Epiphany of the Lord, and throughout the season, that we too will experience many a discovery of how God is with us in our everyday routines. And that in our searching, that we would experience the blessings of Epiphany. the blessings of aha moments, when we realize our God is not distant, but God continues to draw close to us, and we know we are not alone with what we are facing or what we are enduring, and that we today can experience fresh expressions of the Holy Spirit who's at work in the life of the church and in our own lives. As we move through the carol, we have the stanzas that speak of the gifts that are offered, of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And these gifts were well suited for a king, expensive gifts that would provide provisions for Mary and Joseph who were on that unexpected journey to Egypt. But gifts that also prophesy that Jesus would be king. Gold is fit for a king. That Jesus would live a life of holiness, frankincense. And then even when we fix our gaze upon the nativity, that Jesus was not simply come to be born among us, but he was sent to die for us. Myrrh. In this carol that we open up our worship with, it starts out with Christmas and Epiphany feels, but we're not to stay there. We don't even stay there till the end of the carol. We start there with the first few verses, but then before too long, we're invited to Good Friday and then Easter. And on Good Friday, what do we sing about? There is sorrowing and sighing, bleeding and dying, sealed in the stone-cold tomb. As this Christmas season comes to an end and we enjoy the season of Epiphany, where hopefully we will continue to experience more of God in our midst, God's welcome into our own lives, I pray that we will offer gifts that are fit for a king, meaning that we offer our very best to God, not just when we gather on a Sunday morning, that we offer our very best every single day because we're living in response to God's love in our life. I pray that we will continue to offer a way like frankincense where we are living lives of holiness, a life that's pleasing unto God, and that we'll offer myrrh. Symbolic that we who have died in Christ have been raised with Christ, and that we're no longer living for our own lives, but we are living because of Jesus who is indeed in us. And as we do so, may we offer the gift of our worship and find ourselves like the kings, the magi, the sorcerers, the wise men, or whomever they were, offering the gift of worship as we bend down to pay Jesus homage. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.